Hello guys, welcome to H2O, the A to Z of chemistry. I am Dr. Ritu Johar, your educator for this course. Chemical bonding. Today we will begin with lecture 27 from the course, but make sure you watch the previous ones before we this one. So we have been learning about hybridization, the types of hybridization where we have learned already about the sp3 and the sp2 hybridization, and in this lecture we will be discussing about the sp hybridization, and this is what the picture of the sp hybridization looks like. So let us learn what is this sp hybridization. So as the name suggests, sp hybridization means that there is going to be a mixing of one s and one p orbital of the valence shell of an atom, and when they are going to mix with each other, they will be forming two new equivalent orbitals. So two orbitals, because one s and one p make it a total of two. So two orbitals mixing, we will be getting two new ones, both of them identical to each other, and these two orbitals we will be calling them as sp hybrid orbitals. And now, as we know that orbitals, they are the regions of high electron density, so we have two regions of high electron density, and this we can just equate to the two electron pairs as we discussed in the VSEPR theory. So how had we placed those two electron pairs in the VSEPR theory? Well, we placed them so that there is a maximum distance between them, so that there is minimum repulsion between them. So we had placed them on a straight line, they making an angle of 180 degrees. So we are just going to have similarly the position of the orbitals, so that the electrons which are going to occupy these orbitals, they have a minimum repulsion. So they will be at an angle of 180 degree, and the molecules they will be forming as a result of an overlapping with orbitals of other atoms, we will be getting linear molecules. And now, because this is essentially going to be positioned in such a way that we have a straight line, so this is also called as diagonal hybridization. And now, because there is one s and one p orbital making, so we have an equal ratio of both the s orbital character and the p orbital character in the hybrid orbitals. So we will be having 50% of s and 50% of p character in both the sp hybrid orbitals. The common examples where we will be seeing sp hybridization are C2H2, that is the ethyne molecule, BeCl2, carbon dioxide, CS2, HgCl2, etc. So here is a diagrammatic representation how we are having the two orbitals, the s and the p orbitals, and these are going to mix with each other, and as a result of this mixing we will be getting two new hybrid orbitals, and these two hybrid orbitals, they are going to be placed so that the electrons which are going to occupy these orbitals, they are a maximum distance apart. And this is how the maximum distance apart can be obtained. So they will be at an angle of 180 degree, and then the molecules which will be forming from these hybrid orbitals are going to be linear molecules. So the geometry of the molecules from sp hybridization are going to be a linear geometry. So let us consider the example where we have the formation of beryllium chloride. So beryllium in a gaseous beryllium chloride molecule is a central atom with no lone pair of electrons in a linear arrangement of three atoms. So there will be three atoms, beryllium will be in the center and chlorine on the two sides. Right? So, and beryllium, it will not have any lone pair of electrons. So, essentially, it is going to be regions of two electron density that we see in the valence shell, the two covalent beryllium chloride molecules. And if we look at the energy considerations, we have the beryllium in the ground state configuration of the valence shell being 2s2. right? So they are two valence shell electrons, but they are in the same orbital, so therefore they cannot form two bonds. So beryllium, one electron is going to get excited into the 2p orbital. Then we will be getting two half filled orbitals. So two half filled orbitals, they are now going to mix with each other. Mixing with each other, they are going to get resultant two hybrid orbitals, the sp hybrid orbitals. Both of them, they are equivalent in energy. The two orbitals of the p type which will be left behind, they will be unhybridized, because empty orbitals never get hybridized, right? So we have two hybrid orbitals for beryllium, and it is these two hybrid orbitals which are going to overlap with the atomic orbitals of chlorine and give us a resultant beryllium chloride. So you can understand now in the written form also that the s orbital, this mixes with the valence p orbitals. We will be getting sp hybrid orbitals. They will be arranged in a linear geometry, and the sp hybrid orbitals, they are equivalent in nature. The s was different from the p, but we needed two equivalent orbitals because the bonds between beryllium and chlorine, they were of the same kind on either side of the beryllium atom. So the sp hybrid orbitals, they are now equivalent in nature. They point at an angle of 180 degree from each other, and the two s electrons which were seen in the ground state beryllium, they are now distributed into the two sp orbitals which are half filled. And in the gaseous beryllium chloride, these half filled orbitals, they will overlap with the orbitals from the chlorine atoms to form identical sigma bonds. The valence electrons will then therefore occupy the newly created hybrid orbitals, and we see the formation of the beryllium chloride molecule. The two bonds, they are at an angle of 180 degrees, right? I hope this is clear to you people. So the important conclusion from this discussion is that whenever there is a central atom surrounded by just two regions of valence electron density in a molecule, that central atom is going to exhibit sp hybridization. So now what we have learnt is, when there are four regions of valence electron density in a molecule, that atom is going to be sp3 hybridized. When there are three regions of electron density for the central atom, it is going to be sp2 hybridized. And when we have two regions of electron density, it is going to be sp hybridization. Right, so let us see a few more examples. First example is the mercury chloride molecule. Okay, so here mercury is going to be the central atom. It is going to form single sigma bonds with the chlorine atoms, and therefore there are going to be two regions of electron density on either side of the mercury atom, and hence mercury atom is sp hybridized. Similarly, if we see the diethyl zinc molecule, here the zinc atom is going to form a linear structure with the two carbon atoms. So we have a zinc atom in the center, and the two carbon atoms, they are joined to the zinc atom by sigma bonds. So we have two regions of high electron density, and hence this is going to be a linear arrangement of the three atoms. Then if we see the carbon atoms in the ethyne molecule, so this is ethyne, where we have a carbon-carbon triple bond. Here the two carbons, they are going to be sp hybridized. We are just now going to discuss this in detail, because this is going to form an important part of your organic chemistry discussion. And then we have the carbon dioxide molecule. So carbon in the center, there are going to be two oxygens on the side, and they are bonded by double bonds. So carbon double bonded with oxygen on one side, and carbon double bonded with oxygen on the other side. And we have a multiple bond. So whenever we have a multiple bond, we consider that to be a region of single electron density. So one electron density with one oxygen, and the other region of electron density with the other oxygen. So net, we have two regions of electron density. So sp hybridization for the carbon atoms. Okay. So now let us consider the C2H2 molecule, that is the ethyne molecule. And again, it is just very important, just like we considered in sp3 hybridization the ethane molecule, sp2 hybridization we discussed the ethene molecule. Now we have sp hybridization of carbon in the ethyne molecule. So both the carbon atoms, they are going to undergo sp hybridization, and because carbon in the excited state, this has four orbitals which are half filled, and the only two are going to undergo sp hybridization. So this means that there will be left behind two unhybridized orbitals after the sp hybridization of the carbon atoms. So we will be having two unhybridized orbitals, which are the 2py and the 2px orbitals. By convention, we say that the 2pz were the ones which were involved in the sigma bond formation by the head on overlapping. So what do we see over here? We have one sp hybrid orbital of carbon overlapping with the sp hybrid orbital of the carbon, and there is the formation of a carbon-carbon sigma bond. And then after that, one hybrid orbital is going to be left behind. So this is going to overlap with the 1s orbital of hydrogen atom, and we will be seeing the formation of a carbon hydrogen sigma bond on this side also, and on the other side the other carbon as well. And after that, these sigma bonds, they have been formed. What do we see? That they are going to be left behind two unhybridized orbitals. So these two unhybridized orbitals, they are going to overlap with each other, and they are going to form two pi bonds. So you can say that this is a 2py orbital overlapping with a 2py, and a 2px with a 2px. This is going to be a sideways overlapping, and we will be seeing as a result one sigma bond and two pi bonds, right? And if we consider the pi bonding framework, this is going to be the pi bonded framework, right? And because this is going to be a linear geometry of the molecule, as you can see, so you can understand now whenever there is going to be sp hybridization, the molecule, this has a linear geometry. So this is how we represent the ethyne molecule in this fashion, showing the sigma bond between the carbon and hydrogen, the triple bond between the two carbons, and on the other side a sigma bond between the carbon and hydrogen. This is something how we are going to depict them. We will be learning more about in organic chemistry. It is just a matter that we have to discuss all this in organic also, so we are just now trying to have an introduction to these types of molecules, which we are going to discuss in detail in the coming up courses. Now I will be teaching you one very important comparison, the comparison of a single, a double, and a triple bond. So we have seen the formation of the ethane molecule while we were discussing sp3 hybridization, the ethene molecule. When we discussed sp2 hybridization and the ethyne molecule, in this lecture when we discuss the sp hybridization. And now we are going to compare the bond lengths and the bond angles in these three molecules. Okay, so what do we see is that in the ethane molecule, the carbon-carbon bond, this is 153.51 picometer, and the carbon-hydrogen bond, this is going to have a bond length of 109.4 picometer. In case of the ethene molecule, what we see is that the carbon-carbon double bond, the bond length is 133.9 picometer, and the carbon-hydrogen bond length is 108.7 picometer. And in the ethyne molecule, we have the carbon-carbon triple bond length being 120.3 picometer, and the carbon-hydrogen bond being 106.0 picometer, right? So what are we seeing is that from ethane to ethyne, we are seeing that there is a decrease in the carbon-hydrogen bond length. And similarly, from a carbon-carbon single bond to a carbon-carbon triple bond, the bond length is decreasing. So how do we understand this, Well, one thing which you can consider is that here we have only a sigma type of overlapping between the two carbons. Here we are having a two types of overlapping. One is a sigma and the other is a pi overlapping. In between these two carbons where there is a triple bond, we have three overlappings, one of a sigma overlapping and two pi overlappings. So here between the atomic orbitals, essentially we have more overlapping of the atomic orbitals in comparison to the ethane molecule where there is only one type of atomic orbital overlapping. So more is going to be the overlapping, shorter is going to be the bond length, right? So I hope you can understand this. Now one important explanation to this can be based on the hybridization concept as well. So while we were discussing the salient features of hybridization, I was telling you about the correlation between the percentage S character and the shape of the hybrid orbitals. And there I told you more is going to be the percentage S character, shorter is going to be the hybrid orbital and stouter it is, right? And more is going to be the p character, the hybrid orbital that will be longer in size and it will be thinner also, right? So now we have the sp3 hybrid orbitals overlapping over here. So sp3 hybrid orbitals has how much percentage S character? Just 25%. Here it is 33.33% in sp2 hybridization, and in this we have the carbons to be sp hybridized, so 50% S character. So the S character from this carbon to this carbon is increased and the size of the hybrid orbitals has decreased. So if the size of the hybrid orbitals, they have decreased, now you can understand the bond length has decreased. Similarly, you can explain the bond lengths for the carbon hydrogen bonds as well, because this carbon is sp hybridized and this carbon over here, this is going to be sp3 hybridized. So this hybrid orbital, this is going to be the longest and this is going to be the shortest. Therefore, this we have as the shortest bond length from amongst these three, right? I hope this is now clearly understood how we can explain the decrease in the bond length of the carbon hydrogen bond as well as the carbon carbon single bond, the double bond and the triple bond. Now let us see the bond angles. So first we have is the hydrogen carbon hydrogen bond angles for ethane, ethene and ethyne. Let us understand them, which are these bond angles that we are talking about. So we have a hydrogen carbon hydrogen, so we have a hydrogen, a carbon and hydrogen. This is the bond angle, any one of them you can take. So this is the bond angle we are talking about, and then we say the hydrogen carbon carbon bond, so this is the angle which we are talking about. Okay, so let us understand these all bond angles as well, how we explain them. So here this carbon is sp3 hybridized. So in a sp3 hybridization, the geometry of the molecule, that is a tetrahedral geometry, and for a tetrahedral geometry the bond angles should have been 109 degrees and 28 minutes approximately, right? So what are we seeing over here is that this is not 109, but this is 111.17 degrees. So why has this angle increased? That is what we have to understand. So well, you can consider this, that now this is a region where we have a carbon and a carbon being bonded and a carbon and a hydrogen being bonded. Whereas if we consider this bond, this is a hydrogen and a hydrogen. So this hydrogen, this is smaller in size than the carbon atom. So these two atoms, they being smaller in size, they can afford to come closer to each other. This we discussed while we were discussing the VSEPR theory. So they can afford to come closer to each other because they are smaller in size, and therefore there is going to be a position that is required, is the position of minimum repulsion. So these two, they will come closer and this will slide be at a greater angle. Similar explanation we give over here also. For the sp2 hybridization, the angle should have been 120 degree, but we are seeing a slightly higher angle because these two hydrogen atoms, they can afford to come closer, they being in smaller size as compared to the carbon carbon. Okay, And now over here you can understand this way also that this is going to be a region of high electron density because now we have a sigma bond as well as a pi bond being formed. So where we have a sigma bond and we have a pi bond, the electron density has increased. So that the electrons, they can be farther away from each other, these angles, they are slightly greater, and these two, they are coming closer to each other, right? And now again over here also you can have this angle to be 180 degree, and this I think you can explain it now that these are just going to be on the basis of the electron repulsion, so these are going to be farther away from each other, right? So that would be all for this lecture. I hope you have understood this very important point, the comparison of the bond lengths and the bond angles over here. Now the next lecture we will be discussing about the hybridization involving the d orbitals. We will be starting with the sp3d orbitals and then sp3d2 and so on. So I hope you enjoyed this lecture. You have understood everything very well. We have discussed very important things over here. If you have still any doubts, feel free mail us at h2ochemistry@gmail.com. Also, you can put your doubts in the comment section as well. We will be glad to help you all. And now one thing that you have to do is that you have to subscribe to the channel H2O so that you do not miss any details of any concepts of your learning. So please do click on the bell icon as well to get a notification the moment we put up the new lecture for you. And if you've liked the lecture really well, so please do click on the like link before leaving. Thank you and have a nice day. God bless you.